Hello and welcome to our second tutorial in Traffic Dynamics and Simulations Econometrics Master's course. So we start with problem 2.1, use of floating car data. So our problem setting is assume that some vehicles with GPS or generally global navigation systems, GNSS, an accuracy of about 10 meters, and they send data to a traffic control center every 30 seconds. The question is, what can this data reconstruct or be used for and what not? So first, can you be reconstructed trajectories, local and time of lane changes, density, flow, speed, and so on. In order to answer these seven questions, we will just review what can be done with floating car data generally. So let's just first look at precision. That's as in the problem statement, the GNSS uncertainty is of the order of 10 meters. There's also some correlation. And of course, the more satellites you can receive and the more systems you have, such as GPS, GLONASS, Baidu, and all these other systems, the higher the precision is, but rarely it is below 10 meters, unless you have some special earthbound correction in form of differential systems, but this is generally not yet implemented in consumer navigation devices. The temporal resolution, as specified, it's 30 seconds, because only every 30 seconds a message is sent to a traffic control center because of bandwidth and also costs. The spatial resolution, with a sampling rate of 2 minutes, in free traffic, you get only one data point every 30 seconds times the speed. If you have 120 kilometers per hour, so typical freeway speed, that means 2 vehicles per minute, that means 1 vehicle per 30 seconds, that means 1 kilometer per 30 seconds, that means vehicle can cover 1 kilometer between data points. Happily, just as if we need the data, the distance are closer. For example, if we have in a typical jam, 5 meters per second or equivalent to 18 kilometers per hour, we have 5 seconds times 5 meters per second times 30 seconds, it's 150 meters. So it's quite close. So can we generate single trajectories? We have points in space, uncertainty 10 meters. And time, the time is absolutely precise, it's GPS precision, it's atomic clock precision, otherwise position is not possible, but of course only every 30 seconds, so the uncertainty is about 30 seconds. Still, this can be used to connect, the points can be connected and trajectories can be created, because particular if there's congestions, the points are closer, so it's again on an event-oriented basis you get closer points just as it is needed. It's a sort of anti-Murphy. Remember, Murphy's law is if you repair something and the screw falls down, first the screw falls in a way to create the maximum possible damage and then it rolls to the most remote corner so it cannot be retrieved. So our next point, existence and location of congestions. Here again, that's the increased local resolution in jams. We said 150 meters. So whenever a trajectory of an equipped vehicle is recorded, that means whenever a floating car floats by, entering a jam, then the jam font is precise of the order of 150 meters. This is more than enough to create, for example, traffic jam warnings. time resolution. Of course, here it's not only the time resolution of the 30 seconds, but only you get a recording if an equipped vehicle floats by. Consider, for example, a penetration rate of 2%. That's a typical a number, a typical household number. Sometimes it's even higher. Remember, you need navigation systems which are first activated, which are active. That means also upload the data, for example, Google Maps or TomTom Live Service, and are of the same system. So Google will not deliver data to the TomTom's traffic data center, its competitor, and vice versa. So, but still 2% is a good household number. The exact numbers are a highly secret, trade secret. So let's assume a jam, 50 vehicles per kilometer and per lane, three lane directional way of a freeway, that means 150 vehicles per kilometer, times 2%, that gives a partial density of 3 vehicles per kilometer, corresponding to a spatial resolution of 300 meters. So together with this uncertainty, which is hardly higher, we get basically a resolution of 300 meters, which is very good. Temporal, it's similarly. We only get information when a new equipped car floats into a jam front. In jam, so it's not a total still standing traffic, but a slowly moving jam, you have about 1,200 vehicles per hour in lane. That means 3,600 vehicles per hour on a free lane, or one vehicle per second. Multiply this with 0.02, that means 2% penetration rate, and you get one vehicle per 50 seconds. That means about a minute of frequency. To this is of course added the 30 seconds of the time interval between transmission. So basically it sums up to about 1 minute time resolution, more than enough to for jam warnings. Now finally, extensive quantities. Extensive quantities are that those value increase with the number of vehicles. Typically such quantities have vehicles in the numerator of its unit. Or of course, vehicle density springs to mind, vehicles per kilometer, and vehicle flow, vehicles per hour or per second. Can these extensive quantities be estimated by floating car data? The answer is no. Why? Because I told the actual penetration rate is a secret, a trade secret of the people. And even they only know the average penetration rate, but not the actual one, which can change by a factor of 2 or 3. So even the data providers, the manufacturers of the navigation devices do not know the penetration rate, the actual. They may know the average one, but not the actual one. So extensive quantities can only be estimated very roughly, if at all, by a factor of 2 or 3 uncertainty, which typically has no use at all. So you can say there is no way to estimate extensive quantities, particular flow and density with flowing cars. That's the domain of the workhorse still for detectors, which is star stationary detectors. Now we are in a position to answer the 7 specific questions. So let's start with question 1, trajectories of single vehicles. We have seen that this can be done very well. Typical resolution is 150 meters in time in jams and 1 kilometer in free traffic. The precision of the points itself is 10 meters or less, so this is very good. So this can be done, okay. Location and time of lane changes. Let's look at the position. It's 10 meters. And how wide is a lane? Definitely less than 10 meters. Typically on freeways it's 3.7 meters. On rural roads and Bundesstraßen it's about 3.5 meters. And in cities it's maybe even 3.2 meters. In any case, much lower than the typical uncertainty. So no way. And even if you had differential precision, a GPS system, you also need maps, digital maps of that precision, which is also not available today. So a double no. Traffic density, that means vehicles per kilometer. I said there's no way to estimate extensive quantities. That includes also not a traffic density. The same with vehicle flow, it's also not possible. Vehicle speed. Basically, if you have a trajectory, you can also have also this gradient and you have also vehicle speed. However, this if you want it with a high precision, this is not possible because the speed of equipped vehicles can only be recorded, or the position is only recorded every 30 seconds. So the speed is not very precise. So I give it an okay, but with a parenthesis. Length and position of traffic jams. For this, the total uncertainty of 300 meters, including the sampling time uncertainty, the GPS uncertainty, and moreover the time difference where different floating cars arrive at the jumpfronts of about 300 meters. That's clearly enough, that's precise enough for traffic jams which typically are 1 kilometer or longer. So this is very well possible. Traveling time. Of course, this is traveling time is something which is typically interesting for covering a certain road segment, say 10 kilometers. So it's a quite longer time. So it's just from the trajectory time points. It's very well possible to get the travel time. And that's in fact the major advantage of floating cars, that you can estimate the travel time more or less directly and transmit it to the data center. So let's now tackle problem number 2.2. That's an example on what the processor locally do at every stationary detector station. Locally, just the passage times and the speeds, the individual speeds are recorded, and it's recorded to, it's aggregated to obtain macroscopic data. Here we want to aggregate for 30 seconds, so 30 seconds interval, and you see that is the passage time, which one third detector at a certain lane records. So we have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 vehicles with the typical passage times. These have individual speeds. And also, so here, I've aggregated the recordings of the lanes. This is possible because there are separate detectors for each lane. So here on lane 1, we have 6 vehicles. On lane 2, we have 4 vehicles. And finally, as discussed in the lecture, by means of occupancy times and known speeds from double induction loop detectors, we can also estimate the vehicle length. That's just the occupancy time times the independently recorded speed. So now let's just look at the questions. Aggregate the data and calculate macroscopic traffic flow and speed separately for both lanes. On the right lane, we have 6 passing vehicles. 6 passing vehicles in 30 seconds, that is 12 per minute, or 720 vehicles per hour. On the left-hand lane, that is the lane 2, there are four passing vehicles and correspondingly four passing vehicles per 30 minutes, 8 per minute, or 480 per hour. The speed, it's just the arithmetic average on lane 1. You just have 1 divided by 6 divided by all the sum of all vehicles on the right hand lane. That is this plus this plus this plus this plus this plus this, and that gives 25.8 meter per second. In the same way, we also calculate the arithmetic mean speed for the right lane, for the left lane, that's lane 2, 1 divided by 4 times 32 plus 32 plus 34 plus 38, that gives 34 meter per second. So that was question A. Now calculate the traffic density in each lane, assuming that speed and time headway of two succeeding vehicles are uncorrelated, which is realistic for free traffic. And look here, we have the speed left-hand lane of more than 30 meter per second, that is more than 108 kilometer per hour, so typically 120 kilometer per hour, so this is obviously free traffic. And we know from lecture in free traffic, just the ratio arithmetic flow divided by arithmetic mean of speed gives a rather good and unbiased estimate of the density. This is not the case in congested traffic, where the density in this way would be greatly underestimated. So we have calculated flow and speed, so it's pretty easy just to get the ratios. So it's just on lane 1, we have Q1 divided by V1, so 7.74. On lane 2, it's 3.92. So lane 2 was the left lane, the overtaking, the passing lane. So now point C, flow, speed, and density of both lanes combined. For flow and density, it's easy because flow and densities are extensive quantities increasing proportional to the number of vehicles. And that means the total flow and the total density are just the sum of the variables on the single lanes. So we have just the total density is just the sum. That 11.66 vehicle per kilometer. Total flow is just the sum of these. It means 1,200 vehicles per hour. And that, of course, corresponds also if we had not distinguished between lanes, when we have just 10 vehicles in 30 seconds. That means 20 in a minute, or 20 times 60 is 1,200 per hour. So this is consistent. It's more tricky with the speed, as we will see in the lecture, because there are several possibilities, but in order to define the speed that this applies, that means the hydrodynamic relation is also valid for the total flows, which by the way is just how we define the speed here. Then we would just have the total flow is just Q1 plus Q2, and if we so it's just Q tot, total flow, and the total density is just this plus this, Q1 V1 plus Q2 V2, and this is in fact the weighted harmonic speed mean of the single lanes. It's weighted with the flows, because if you this Q tot, if you put it into the denominator, it gets into the denominator of a denominator, so we have 1 over Q1 divided by Q tot times 1 over V1 plus Q2 over Q tot divided by 1 over V2. And that's just with weightings, Q1, V1 would be Q1 divided by Q tot and so on. So it's just the weighted harmonic mean. Remember, the harmonic mean just means 1 over the harmonic mean speed is just the arithmetic means of the 1 over the individual speeds, and that's just this definition. So finally, question D, the percentage of attack percentage. And if it's possible to use the relative drag counting to assess the drag partial density or partial flow. So first the drag percentage of the right and the left lane. How to determine the drag? We can just say here it's obvious there are only two drags. These are all cars between 3 and 5 meters. Remember, you can distinguish a motorcycle length less than 2 meters, drag maybe greater than 8 meters, and everything else is a car. Maybe you have also to distinguish trailers, cars with trailing a motorhome or so. But here, simple, just cars and trucks. There are two trucks, which, as it should be, drive on the right-hand lane, lane one. So the partial flow on the is 1/3 for trucks on the right-hand lane, and none on the left. And we have 2 out of 10, 20% in total. So it again depends on the definition, how you define the total drag. Obviously, the drag partial flow of the total is just 20%, or the partial flow, of course, as extensive quantities, is just that of the right-hand lane, because there's no drag on the left-hand lane. Now, let's come to the last question of this tutorial 02, that is how to determine macroscopic quantities from single vehicle data. It's basically what could be done locally at the local processor of the detector station. Sometimes it's done, sometimes not. So let's just consider the situation. We have a two-lane directional road, for example, the north direction of a two-lane per direction freeway. On the left-hand lane, all vehicles are driving at 140 km per hour, and on the right-hand lane with 72 km per hour. That is basically, we saw this artificial scenario already in the lecture. Here in the tutorial, we will just treat it quantitatively and calculate with it. The first question, what is the time headway on both lanes? What are the time gaps, assuming all vehicles are 5 meters long? The time headway includes also the occupancy time. And so you need just to determine the distance headway, and that is given. It's just 60 meters on the right and on the left hand lane. And so all is stationary homogeneous, so we have always distance headway of 60 meters. And then we need to transform the kilometer per hour speed into a meter per second speed. As I stress always, whenever you do internal calculations, transform all the units to SI units, to metric units, and do all the calculations there. And at the end, in order to present the results, of course, use whatever units are expected by your audience. So here, 144 km per hour, that is 40 meters per second. We need to divide it just by 3.6. 40 meters per second. And that means the time headway is just the distance headway, 60 meters, divided by the speed, 40 meters per second. That's 1.5 seconds. And here the speed is half, and of course gives a distance headway of 3 seconds. Now the time headway, for the time headway, we need to subtract the occupancy time from the distance, from the time headway. So time gap is time headway minus occupancy time. The occupancy time is just the time each of these vehicles cover its 5 meters of length. So here with 20 meter per second, we have one fort, 0.025 seconds, and as occupancy time, and here we have a point 0.125 seconds. So here we have 1.5 minus 0.125 gives 1.375 time gap, and here it's again the double, it gives 2.7 as time gap. Let's now come to finding the macroscopic properties. First, separately for each lane, traffic flow, occupancy, average speed, and then for all lanes together. So first, separately for each lane, it's of course simple because we have stationarity and homogeneity. Stationarity means constant in time, and homogeneity means constant in space. So we can just say the flow is just one divided by the time headway, because the time headway is the same for all vehicles. That means on the left lane we have flow 1/3 seconds and 1/1.5 seconds. That's 2,400 vehicles per hour. And on the right hand line we have 1/3 seconds. That's 1,200 vehicles per hour. Similarly, the occupancy, it's just the ratio of the occupancy time divided by the time headway. So on the left lane, it's occupancy day we have calculated is 0.125 seconds divided by 1.5 seconds gives 8.3%. And the same is also true for the right lane, where the numerator and denominator is just doubled. The speed is of course the same as the individual speeds. That means 144 kilometers to the left and 72 kilometers on the right hand side. Now we come to the average for both lanes. Again, flow as extensive quantity, it's just the sum of the individual flows, and the lane average flow is 1,800, because the left hand lane was 2,400, the right hand lane 1,400, sum 3,6, and average 1,800. Occupancy is of course the same left and right, and of course it's not added up because occupancy is not an extensive quantity, but a relative quantity, so it's just the same, because it's the same left and right, it's just 0.083. Otherwise, this would just be the simple arithmetic average, if it's a non-trivial situation. So now let's come to arithmetic time, mean speed. It's just as usual, the sum of all vehicles in the denominator, and in the numerator the sum of all the individual speeds. So basically this boils down to just a flow weighted arithmetic average of the speed of a single lanes, with the result 120 km per hour. Harmonic time mean speed, that's basically 1/harmonic time mean speed is the arithmetic mean over the 1/ individual speeds. And if you just calculate this, you get 108 km per hour, and that's a lower value, and that's quite generally true, as we have proven in the lecture. The harmonic time mean speed is always lower than the arithmetic time mean, only if all individual speeds are the same, then of course also the both means are the same. Let's now come to question C. In basically, we have four ways of averaging the speed. We can first average mathematically arithmetic or harmonic speed, as we've just done, and we can also do it over space and over time. Of course, if we have stationary detectors, there's only the time averaging left. And so there's the following statement. The arithmetic mean speed of a road is equal to the simple arithmetic mean speed of the two lanes. So let's just look how we can derive the relation between time and space mean and between arithmetic and harmonic speed mean. Let's first just define the space mean. It's just at a snapshot the mean of all vehicles which are in a certain road segment. That means, of course, if there are more vehicles on a certain lane than on the other, then this lane is weighted more. So basically the weighting factor are density on a lane divided by the total density. And that of course is valid for all lanes. And the numerator is then just density times speed summed over all lanes. That means basically the total flow. And the denominator we write as total density is just flow lane I1 divided by speed lane 1, and the same for lane 2. This is the space mean. So that means we have weighted it by the density. For a time mean means we have fixed location and take average over the time. And that basically means the weighting is not with the density, but with a flow divided by the total flow. So we have just the simple arithmetic mean. Interesting is now the space mean, that because this is just the definition of an weighted harmonic mean, because we have the speed in the denominator of a denominator, that means 1 over the harmonic speed would be just the weighted arithmetic mean weighted with the partial flows. So we have an interesting relation. The space mean can be approximated at least in this case of stationarity by the harmonic time mean. The final question is about the speed variance. Of course, because we have only time averages, also the speed variance is understood as calculated with the time mean. Of course, there would be also a spatial variance, but this is not available if we have only stationary detectors. So let's just use the normal definition of variance. It's just the expectation of a squared difference between the individual speeds and the arithmetic speed average. And then we have simply arithmetic average over all vehicles, of course. We have 60 vehicles in this aggregation time, and then just 40 times the squared difference on the right-hand line plus 20 times on the left-hand line gives a result of 88.9 meter squared divided by second squared. Of course, the intra-lane variance is zero, because by assumption, all vehicles on the right and the left lanes move with the same speed. This was the second tutorial of traffic dynamics of simulations in Econometrics Master's Course. Stay tuned for the next lessons and tutorials. Many thanks.